Friends, welcome to GYAS. How are you? I hope you are doing well. So friends, as you know that on our channel, we are covering the syllabus of UPSC Civil Services. And for that purpose, we have started MCQ series of different topics like Ancient India, Medieval India, Modern India, Polity, Geography, Environment, etc. So what we are doing in these series, we basically cover your questions and MCQs. So daily, what we do, we have allotted 6 days of the week for a particular series. Earlier what we used to do, we used to cover 5 questions of each series. But now we have devoted a particular day to a particular topic. For example, for Ancient India, the day is Monday. And for Medieval India, the day is Tuesday. In this way, we have devoted particular days. And also on those particular days, what we cover, we cover your daily 30, we cover 30 questions of that topic. So earlier what we used to do, we covered different series and of each series we covered 5 questions, but now ultimately we have changed this pattern and we are making it more user friendly by covering the one topic per day. So in this way you will be getting 30 questions of each topic on particular day of that topic. So I have already uploaded the revised timetable. You can see it in my playlist and you can get the idea about that on which day which topic is focused upon. So today is the topic of environment and ecology, and we have already covered 46 lectures, and now we are on the 47th lecture of this environment series. The first question is, instead of spreading paddy seeds on the field, saplings are sown. Why? So friends, here the question has been asked that we plant the sapples and saplings are sown instead of just throwing the seeds in the field. So why it is done so? So options are, it increases survival chances of the crop, it reduces attack from pests, it allows more use of fertilizers in the field. If seeds are thrown directly on the ground, roots may not penetrate deep. So friends, the correct answer is that it increases the survival chances of the crop. So it is not the case that it has been practiced from recent time. We are practicing this practice of sowing saplings from ancient times. So basically it increases the survival chances of the crop. So the solution is A. And here is the solution, and let's see about explanation that people began about transplanting paddy against paddy since ages. So in this case, what is done, instead of scattering, their saplings are grown and then planted in the fields. So this is about explanation part. Now let's move on to your second question. The second question is, which of these nations do not have any non-mineral deposit? So here we have been asked that which of the following nations do not have any non-mineral deposit. The options are Uganda, Switzerland, Georgia, none of the above. So friends, here we have been asked that in which of the following the mineral deposits are not. So let me tell you friends that your NCERT of 7th class book, your NCERT of 7th class of geography, it basically says the Switzerland has no resources. But let me tell you, 2-3 years back, gold was discovered there in Switzerland. So now there is no country among the given options that doesn't have any mineral deposits. So the solution is D. So here is the solution given to you people, the solution is D, and this is about the explanation part, that Switzerland answer is given but it is wrong. So a few years back gold has been discovered, so it does not mine gold though. So let's move on to your third question. Third question is, which of these crops plants are not native to India and have been brought here from abroad for cultivation? So here we have been asked that which of the following are not cultivated, they are not native to India but brought from outside. So the options are lotus, first is lotus, second is jasmine, third is mango. So I repeat, lotus, jasmine and mango. So we have to choose the correct answer using the codes below, that is 1 and 2, 2 and 3, it's 3. And D, all are native to India. So let me tell you friends that the answer is D, that is all are native to India. There is no such plant which is mentioned here which has been not native to India. So the correct answer is all are native to India. So mangoes grows on trees range from 30 to 100 feet native to India, and mangoes have been grown since prehistoric times, and lotus is native to India and is an important religious symbol in Hinduism as well as in Buddhism. So it jasmine is very fragrant and evergreen vine or shrub, and it is also native to India and other tropical areas of Asia, Africa and Australia. So there are many varieties of jasmine. So let's move on to your fourth question. The fourth question is, 193 member states of United Nations had reached an agreement on the outcome document of new sustainable development agenda for the next 15 years. The new agenda draft document is called. So friends, let me tell you that UNFCCC 2-3 years back came with a new sustainable development agenda. When the Millennium Development Goals ended, it came with the new development agenda. So here we have been asked that what is the official name of this document? A is towards new development, the 2030 agenda for sustainable development. B is a brave new world, 2030 agenda for sustainable development. C is transforming our world, the 2030 agenda for sustainable development. And then the fourth option is D, people, planet and peace, 2030 agenda for sustainable development. So let me tell you friends that the correct option is C, that is transforming our world, the 2030 agenda for sustainable development. So basically the answer solution is C, and so basically there are 17 non-binding goals in it, and also 169 specific targets that focus upon different socio-economic goals issues. And there are earlier there were Millennium Development Goals, but now there are Sustainable Development Goals, SDGs. So this is about your our fourth question. Next, let's move on to fifth question. Fifth question is, depth of weathering mantle is more in tropical forest than in tundra. So the factors contributing to this are, so friends, weathering mantle is more in tropical forest than in tundra regions, that is polar regions. So which are the factors that contribute to it? So first is higher moisture and water availability, second high temperature, third is more active biological weathering. So we have to choose the correct quotes. So let me tell you friends that all of these play an important role in high weathering mantle in case of tropical rainforests, because there the moisture is also high and water availability is high and temperature is also high, and there is more active biological weathering because there is robust biological life in these areas. So the answer is D, that is all of the above. So here is the solution. So explanation is, weathering, basically the thickest weathering mantles, they form in periods of tectonic activity in regions with moist and warm climates. So decomposition takes place, and basically weathering in this way takes place. Now let's move on to the sixth question. Sixth question is, the Mediterranean climate is characterized by hot dry summer and mild rainy winter due to influence of, first is influence of subtropical high in summer, second is westerly wind in winter. Which of the following is correct? So friends, you know that Mediterranean climate, which is basically in which there are summers, we find summers, but they are hot and dry, but we find mild winters. So they are basically this rainy departure due to influence, and this it is characterized by these conditions, and through which it has the following influence. The statements are, one, influence of subtropical high in summer, second is westerly wind in winter. So here we have been asked that which of the following plays an important role in determining the climate of the Mediterranean area. So friends, let me tell you that both these things play an important role. So the answer is both 1 and 2. So the solution is C, that is both 1 and 2. So basically it occurs across Mediterranean Sea along with the western coast of continents and subtropical latitudes of 30-40 degree latitudes like Central California, Central Chile, along the coast in southern, eastern, southwestern Australia. So these areas basically come under subtropical high in summer and westerly wind in winter. So the climate is basically characterized by hot and dry summer and mild and rainy winter. So monthly temperature in summer is around 25 degrees Celsius, and in winter below 10 degrees. So let's move on to your seventh question. The seventh question is the Chipko Andolan, that is Hug the Trees movement, was concerned with A. Local communities losing control and official management of forest resources. B. Government's legitimate right to cut trees in a hilly area. C. Global warming caused due to deforestation. D. Stopping alienation of people from their forests. So basically, friends, let me tell you that this Chipko Andolan was popularized in the decade of 1970, and it was basically with the associated with stopping alienation of people from their forest. So Chipko Andolan was a kind of a grassroots level, and it got much attention of the nation or as well as worldwide. It got much attention. So it was this movement basically originated in a remote village called Raini in Garhwal region. So that village what the contractors they were trying to cut the trees that were in the forest adjoining a village. So what the local people did, they just went and simply hugged the trees. So they made it difficult for them to cut the trees. So this was basically to stopping the alienation of people from their forest. So it's please remember this, that originated in Raini village in Garhwal. So the solution is D. So here is the explanation about which you can see in explanation PDF. So let's move on to your seventh question. Which of the following continents does not have any mega diversity centers, ecological hotspots characterized by IUCN? So here we have been asked, friends, that where we do not found these mega diversity centers. A is Europe, B North America, C Australia, D Africa. So let me tell you, friends, that we doesn't find any ecological hotspot or mega diversity centers in Europe. So the correct answer is A, that is Europe. And I have included a map here also, so you can see here. Sorry friends, there is a Chipko Andolan. So solution is C, that is Europe. And let me show you the map, that where are the mega diversity centers basically located. So here you can see the map. So these are basically in the Central American lowland forests and Central American highland forests. And here you can Western Ecuador and Colombian Choco. So let me tell you that here also, friends, you can't see any hotspot in Northern America. So but in Southern America there are, that like Western Ecuador and Colombian Choco and Atlantic forest and tropical Andes. And also in Africa there does exist ecological hotspot, that is Upper Guinean forest, and also here Eastern Arc Mountains Tanzanians, and also Eastern Madagascar, as well as in India also Western Ghats and the Eastern Himalayas. So Indonesia and also Northern Borneo and Peninsular Malaysia and Philippines, all these have the ecological hotspots in the world. So let's move on to your next question, eighth question. Which of the following gases are generated in the decomposition process of slurry in a biogas plant? First option is methane, second is carbon dioxide, third is hydrogen, fourth is hydrogen sulfide. So here we have been asked that when the in a biogas plant the slurry is decomposed, then which of the following gases are released? So let me tell you, friends, that all these gases, that is methane, carbon dioxide, hydrogen and hydrogen sulfide, are released during the decomposition process. So solution is D, that is D. So here biogas basically in which it generates multiple gases like methane, carbon dioxide, hydrogen and hydrogen sulfide. So next is ninth question. Rate of breathing in aquatic organisms is much faster than seen in terrestrial organisms. This may be because of. So friends, you might have seen that the terrestrial organisms, that in them the rate of breathing is less as compared to the aquatic organisms. The aquatic organisms have much high rate of breathing. So this may be a particularly a cause of. The options are, water is a denser medium than air. B, aquatic organisms lie at a lower trophic level than terrestrial organisms. C is amount of oxygen dissolved in water is fairly low as compared to that in air. D is aquatic organisms are not biologically as old as the terrestrial organisms. So let me tell you, friends, that the option that is correct is C, that is water is not that much oxygen is not that much devolved in the dissolved in the water. So that's why for to meet the body needs of the oxygen, these aquatic animals, or we can say aquatic biodiversity, has very high rates of respiration or we can say with breathing. So this is solution is C. So the basically animals have evolved themselves to get adjusted to different conditions, and this in but in case of trust in case of terrestrial organ animals the, if there is a, there is a plenty oxygen available in atmosphere, but in case of aquatic life the oxygen is fairly low compared to the amount of oxygen in the air. So the rate of breathing in aquatic organisms is much faster. So let's move on to your 10th question. If you observe the bottom of a cooking vessel getting blackened on a gas stove, it means that. So friends, sometimes we simply see our utensils getting blackened, and they turn black in color from the bottom when the from where the heat is applied. So the options are that why that surface or that we can say particular layer is blackened. The options are A, the gas fuel contains very high amounts of carbon. B, the gas fuel contains lead. C, the air holes of the stove are blocked and the fuel is getting wasted. D, is the gas fuel contains blue carbon. So let me tell you friends that the correct option is C. That is, air holes of the stoves are blocked, and due to which there is not proper combustion of fuel taking place, and the fuel that comes it becomes yellow in colors, and also it releases soot. So that soot is deposited and on the surface of the on the lower base of the utensil, and that's why the utensil turns black. So the solution is the air holes of the stoves are blocked. So that's why proper combustion doesn't take place, and also due to which the improper combustion and the soot is released, so which is deposited on the base surface. So this is about your 10th question. Here you can see the explanation. So about which you can get the idea in the explanation PDF. And now comes the 11th question. Consider the following statements. The assertion is carbon plays a very important role in sustaining life on Earth. Reason is carbon is the most abundant element in the Earth's crust. So let me tell you friends that we have to choose the correct answer. So let me tell you that yes, carbon do play an important role in the sustaining life on Earth, because every living component that is found on Earth has been made of compounds of carbons and hydrogen. So carbon plays an important role in sustaining life on Earth. Yes, but let me tell you that carbon is not the most abundant element in Earth's crust. In fact, the most abundant element in Earth's crust is oxygen, and after that comes the silica. So carbon is not most abundant. So the A is correct, but R is incorrect. So as per these conditions, the correct answer is C. That is, A is correct and R is incorrect. So the solution is C. So here you can read about explanation, and oxygen and silica are the most abundant on the Earth's crust. So now let's move on to the 12th question. 12th question is ozone layer is thicker at poles as compared to tropics. A possible reason is, so friends, here we have been asked that on poles the ozone layer is thicker. So why it is so? Why it is not thicker at the tropical levels? So here we have to tell the reason. So A is lower insulation received at poles to break ozone down. B is lower breakdown of ozone layer due to free radicals. C, greater albedo coming from the ice sheets at poles. D is none of the above. So let me tell you friends that the correct answer is B. A. That is lower solar insulation received at poles to break ozone down. So friends, basically what happens? The sunlight that it comes at an inclination towards the pole. So though not much sunlight is received there. So when the sunlight is not received there much, so obviously there is no decomposition of ozone. So ozone is found there in large amount. So there are also multiple other reasons for this. That is particular wind patterns of the seasonal wind patterns that push the ozone in towards the polar areas, and also we can say that over the equator the stratosphere in which ozone is found. It is much thinner in size as compared to over poles. Over poles, the troposphere is of less height, and the stratosphere in comparison gains a considerable size, and in this way there is a larger density of ozone over the poles. So there are multiple reasons for this. So out of these reasons, A is also one of the reasons. So typically thicker over the poles than over the equator for three reasons. So there is lack of sunlight, and also second, seasonal wind systems and wind patterns are almost they are of that type that they push more ozone towards the poles in winter. and also over the equator, the troposphere itself becomes 18 kilometer, but in case of poles it thins to only to 8 kilometers. So that's why the remaining space is occupied by stratosphere, and the stratosphere has higher thicker ozone in polar areas. So let's move on to 12th question. 12th question is sea level rise is projected to have negative impacts on. So here we have been asked that the sea levels would cause negative impacts on A, human settlements, second tourism, third freshwater supplies, fourth fisheries, fifth wetlands. So we have to choose the correct answer using the codes below. So let me tell you that, friends, yes, sea level rise impact all of these, because obviously in coastal areas the human settlements would be affected, the tourism would also be affected because due to the inundation of coastal areas. For example, Maldives is an important tourism place, into tourism hub. So but in case of its inundation, so what happens basically, the tourism would get affected. And also, friends, the freshwater of supplies would also be affected. Why, friends? Because the purpose is the what happens is the that the coastal coastal water, that is marine water, exert pressure on the freshwater supplies of the groundwater. And also fisheries are affected because sea level rise affects fisheries and wetlands also. So all of the above would be affected. So let's move on to your 13th question. 13th question is, which of the following can help reduce global warming and its effects? So friends, here we have been asked that which of the following can reduce the global warming. First is reducing the use of nitrogenous fertilizers in agriculture. Second is increasing the vegetation cover. Third is reducing urban heat islands. So let me tell you, friends, that yes, first thing is important. Reducing the use of nitrogenous fertilizers in agriculture can certainly reduce global warming, because the use of these nitrogen fertilizers releases nitrous oxide in the atmosphere, which is basically a greenhouse gas. And also, due to the increase in vegetation cover, it will act as a the increased vegetation cover will act as a carbon sink. So this is also correct. Regarding the third, this is also correct, because urban heat islands, basically they keep the temperature up in the night also, in the case of night also. But if we reduce urban heat islands, then certainly the temperature, the average temperature of cities will be reduced, and in this way global warming will be reduced. So the answer is the correct answer is D, that is all of the above. So the solution is D. So here is the explanation, you can see it in the explanation PDFs. So let's move on to your fourth question. Viruses can spread from host plant to other plants through, first is seeds, second is pollens, third is insects, third is insect vectors, fourth is fungi. So we have to choose the correct code. So let me tell you, friends, that viruses can spread from host plant to other plants through all of the above things. So this is the simple, it is very simple, because they can spread through these. So the simple solution is D, that is all of the above. So let's move on to your 15th question. 15th question is, biopesticides can be used for the control of. So dear friends, you might have heard about the term called biopesticides. So here we have been asked that they can be used for the control of, first is weeds, second is insects, third is pathogens. So we have to choose the correct answer. So friends, this is also very easy question, because you can easily say that yes, they also prevent the weeds from expanding, and also check the insects and also pathogens also. So all of the above is the answer of this also. So the solution is D. So the MCQ is quite easy today, friends. But on some days it becomes quite tough. So don't worry, don't get overconfident. Yes, there must be some confidence in you, but don't get overconfident, because this also hampers your progress, because you become then complacent. The complacency comes in. So don't allow it to come in you. So the correct answer is D, that is all of the above. So biopesticides basically are certain. They are particular type of pesticides and they are developed from natural materials like animals, bacteria, and basically what they do, they consist of a microorganism, and they prevent all the growth of the weeds, the insects, and the pathogens. So here is the explanation, but the conventional pesticides are synthetic materials. Let's move on to your 16th question. Consider the following with reference to the environment-based grouping conference of parties. So friends, you might have heard about conference of parties multiple times. A lot of news come in Hindu as well as other newspapers about the conference of parties. So what is basically conference of parties? First is the parties in conference of parties refers to nations signatory to UNFCCC. Second is Kyoto Protocol was signed by conference of parties. Third is conference of parties has been successful in establishing binding emission target for all nations. So I repeat, the parties in COP refers to nations signatory to UNFCCC. Second is Kyoto Protocol was signed by conference of parties. Conference of parties has been successful in establishing a binding emission target for all nations. So we have to choose the correct answer. So let me tell you friends that that the correct answer is A, that is 1 and 2 only. Yes, the conference of parties are those parties that have signed United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change, and also friends and this Kyoto Protocol was signed by conference of parties, which was basically to reduce the emission of greenhouse gases. But let me tell you that it has been not successful in establishing binding emission targets for all the nations. So there are some disputes earlier also and now also. So the correct answer is 1 and 2 only, that is A. So solution is A. So in detail you can see that there are 197 signatories and you can read about them more. Basically this framework convention came into force in 1994, but it was drafted in 1992 in the Earth Summit of Rio de Janeiro. So it came into force in 1994, and after that the parties which were signatory to this United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change, they came to be referred to as Conference of Parties. So basically they meet every year to set the binding emission targets. So next is 17th question. Biofertilizers improves the productivity of crops. A, it increases the nutrient content of the soil. B is it makes greater amount of nutrients available to the plant from the same soil. C is it inflates the root hairs, increasing their mineral absorption capacity. D is all of the above. So we have to choose the correct answer. So let me tell you friends that the biofertilizers, how they increase the productivity of crops. Basically what they do, they make greater amounts of nutrients available to the plants from the same soil. So the soil is same, but what they do, they simply occupy the rhizosphere area of the trees, and they simply make the available nutrient, they make the nutrients available to the plants, and in this way they increase the productivity. So they do the nitrogen fixation. So also nitrogen is obviously there, so but they do, what they could, they contribute to its fixation. So they make the availability of the nutrients that are already present in the soil. So this is the role played by the biofertilizers. But the fertilizers, chemical fertilizers are different because they directly apply the chemicals to the soil. So this is the difference between biofertilizers, which make them available, and fertilizers in which these nutrients are kind of ingrained. So this the correct answer is B, that is it makes greater amount of nutrients available to the plant from the same soil. The solution is B. So biofertilizer basically substance from living microorganisms. So they add nutrients through natural processes of nitrogen fixation, solubilizing phosphorus, and stimulating plant growth through the synthesis of growth promoting substances. So let's move on to your 18th question. 18th question is, as per study conducted by the Bangladesh India Joint Tiger Census Project, what are the reasons for the declining population of Bengal tiger? So friends, let me tell you that in 2015 a joint census was conducted by Bangladesh India Joint Tiger Census Project, which estimated the population of Royal Bengal tiger to be decreasing, and there were many reasons that were cited for its decline, and we have been given the choices that we have to choose, that which of the following are the prominent reasons. So first is lack of proper forest management. Second is animal-human conflict. Third is loss of habitat. Fourth is unchecked poaching. So which of the following is correct? So let me tell you that all of the above reasons are responsible for the decline of tiger population as per the report of the Bangladesh India Joint Tiger Census Project. So all of these are responsible. So basically this Royal Bengal tiger is found in Sundarbans. So its population declined to 106 from earlier from 2 4 earlier from 414 2004, so there was a considerable decline in population. So the tiger census of 2015 we saw a considerable decline. So it was basically conducted by Bangladesh India Joint Tiger Census Project, and then it was carried under the initiative of strengthening regional cooperation for wildlife protection in Asia project. The financial support to this initiative was provided by the World Bank. So methodology was basically that was followed to calculate the tiger population was based on modern technology, that is of hidden cameras to count the tigers. Earlier what was used, but which practice was followed earlier, the methodology was based on counting of pug marks of the tiger, but now the methodology that was followed was hidden camera. So this is an important thing, please remember it. And also remember the threats to the tiger population, royal Bengal tiger. And also do remember that basically this initiative, that is India Bangladesh joint tiger census project, this has been carried under this initiative of strengthening regional cooperation for wildlife protection in Asia project. So it was basically funded by the World Bank. So this is about your 18th question. So here you can see the Sundarbans are their main habitat. Next is the 19th question. Consider the following about a species found in India. First is it is critically endangered bird species as per IUCN. Second is it can be found in Gujarat, Maharashtra and Rajasthan. Third is an artificial breeding program for the species was announced by the government. Fourth is greater population of the species is found in the grassland. So we have to choose that to which species the statements are referring. Remember that it is critically endangered and it is found mainly in Gujarat, Maharashtra and Rajasthan. So let me tell you friends that the options are spoon-billed sandpiper, B is white-bellied heron, C is great Indian bustard, D is forest owlet. So let me tell you friends that the critically endangered species is great Indian bustard. So the solution is C. It is quite common question and easy question. So great Indian bustard has been exterminated from almost its earlier 90% of its earlier range. So even though it has the ability to survive in the harsh weather conditions. So there are major reasons that are responsible for its decline are the habitat loss and their poaching. So this is about your 19th question. Let's move on to your 20th question. 20th question is estuaries and recesses in coastlines that form bays can tackle heavy storms, cyclones and tsunamis. So these bays are formed by A. Turtle shells, B. Coral reefs, C. Sea grass, D. Mangroves. So let me tell you that bays are formed by basically by mangroves. And mangroves, due to their entangled structure of roots, they prevent the shock of, they kind of absorb the shock of heavy storms, cyclones and tsunamis. So the correct answer is D, that is mangroves. So you can read about it in detail in the explanation PDF. So let's move on to your next question, that is 21st question. 25th question is ocean acidification can affect marine life by. So friends, ocean acidification is taking place. You know that we are using fossil fuels, and also there are other activities through which ocean acidification is taking place. So it can affect, first, inhibiting shell growth in marine animals. Second, affecting the growth of phytoplanktons. Third, reducing the amount of coral reefs formed. So let me tell you friends that yes, first is found by the researchers and scientists that it inhibits the growth of shells in marine animals, and also friends, second is correct, because scientists have found that with the increase in acidification it affects the growth of phytoplanktons, and which will ultimately affect the entire food chain of the aquatic ecosystem, food chain and food web of the aquatic ecosystem. So but let me tell you, the third is not the correct, because it doesn't reduce the amount of coral reefs formed. So ocean acidification has nothing to do with the coral reefs. So the correct answer is 1 and 2 only. So A is the answer, solution is A. So here we have provided you detailed explanation which you can see in the explanation PDF. Next, let's move on to the 22nd question. Which of the following e-waste cannot be recycled? First is lead, second is copper, third is gold, fourth is silver, and fifth is platinum. So friends, here it has been asked that which of the following cannot be recycled. Friends, there is no such thing that cannot be recycled. Everything can be recycled. So all of these can be recycled. So the correct answer is D. So friends, solution is D. So these are very simple questions. Friends, let me tell you that today I have intentionally framed the questions very easy so as to boost your morale. So please remain motivated. So the UPSC is not the thing that will ask you something that is otherworldly. So you don't have to worry about that. You prepare with consistent efforts. You don't get overconfident in too easy quizzes, and don't get too demotivated in tough quizzes. So this is the best strategy. In this way you will sail through the prelims exam. So let's move on to your next question. 23rd question is, fungi depend on which mode of nutrition? First is autotrophic, second is heterotrophic, third is saprotrophic, fourth is parasitic. So let me tell you friends that fungi depends on two modes, that is saprotrophic and parasitic. So the correct answer is it must be third and four. Third. So here is a mistake, friends. In the typing, there is typing error. So it has both saprotrophic form of nutrition as well as parasitic. So the correct answer is third and four only. So the correct answer should be third and four only. But here it is typing mistake where it is written that the third only. Please correct it. Remember that it fungi acts as a parasite also, that lives on the host or inside the host, and also it acts as a saprophyte. The saprophytes, what they do, they basically they feed on the dead organic matter by releasing certain enzymes from their body, and in these enzymes turn the dead organic matter into simpler compounds, and then they eat it. These organisms, they consume these simpler substances. So in this way, the fungi acts both as a parasite and also it is a saprophyte. So these saprophyte organisms, as I have already told you, that they derive their food from dead organisms. So also they are parasitic in nature. 24th question is, acid rain can be harmful for? So friends, it is a quite easy question. You will be able to answer it. Buildings, monuments, plants, animals. So the obvious solution is D. So it is a very easy question, because obviously acid rain will affect the buildings, the monuments, the plants, and the animals. There is no doubt about it. So basically acid rain takes place due to carbonic acid, nitric acid and sulfuric acid. So in this way the acid rain takes place, which affects the life as well as the human property alike. So let's move on to your 25th question. Organic matter can be added to soil too. So friends, here we have been asked that why the organic matter is added to the soils. So let me tell you friends that the first, improve nutrient base of soil, second, reduce the acidity of soil, third is increase the activity of microorganisms in the soil. So let me tell you friends that the correct answer is that organic matter is added to, yes, first is correct, that to improve the nutrient base, but second is incorrect, because organic matter is itself acidic in nature, so it doesn't reduce the acidity of soil. In fact, it increases, or it neutralizes the two basic soil. So the answer, so the second is not correct, but the third is correct. It increases the activity of microorganisms in soil. So the correct answer is 1 and 3 only, that is C. So excessive use of chemical fertilizers sometimes turn soil acidic. So for that purpose, we add basic things to neutralize it, like cuc lime, that is calcium oxide, and we can slaked lime, like calcium hydroxide. But in case the soil turns too basic, then acids are added, for example organic matter, and also it increases activity of certain microorganisms. So the solution is C. So let's move on to your 26th question. 26th question is, migratory birds flying for long distances generally fly in high in the sky. What can be the possible reason? So here we have been asked that what can be the possible reason that the migratory birds, they fly for long distances generally high in the sky. So first, they can escape thunder and rain. Second, wind flow is helpful at such height. Third is, conditions are cold, which allow them to disperse heat generated by flight muscles. So let me tell you friends that all of these statements are correct. That is D, all of the above is correct. They can escape thunder and rain at height, and also they at that height the wind flow is helpful, and also the conditions are cold there, and when they fly, the heat that is generated through by the flight muscles, it gets consumed, or it disperses by when they disperse their wings. So solution is D. all of the above. So the solution here is the explanation about which you can read in explanation PDF. So let's move on to your 27th question. So 27th question is, which while going through a tropical rainforest you are likely to find which of these species? So here we have been asked that, for example, you are going through a tropical rainforest, take for example Western Ghats, and then we will be most probably seeing first red-eyed frog, second new world monkey, third is I don't know how to pronounce it, Toucan, I don't know how to pronounce it, sorry for it, and fourth is lion-tailed macaw. So let me tell you, friends, that all of these are found in tropical rainforests. So the correct answer is D, that is all of the above. So the solution is D. So it these species are mentioned in your NCERT. So that's why I picked them. So please keep note of such species that and images of such species that are mentioned in NCERT. So UPSC mostly frames questions from this from such type of sources. So the correct answer is so please have a look on such prominent facts, because they are very likely to come in your exams. So let's move on to your 28th question. 28th question is, India's energy dependence on imported energy sources is in which of the following? So here we have been asked that in which of the areas we are dependent upon the imports. First, coal. Second, nuclear fuel. Third, biofuels. Fourth, natural gas. So friends, let me tell you that in first, second and fourth, we are dependent upon imports. We import coal also, we import nuclear fuel also, and we import natural gas also. And this is also one of the major reasons of vulnerability of India. It is of that's why nowadays the task discussion has been going on, that how to build the buffer stocks in case of any security threat of these energy sources. But because if they are not available to India at proper time, then certainly India's economy will be facing hurdles, because ours is a growing economy, and economy can grow only if there are energy sources and they are meeting the demands of the energy. So the answer is all 1, 2 and 4, that is B. So the solution is B. So let's move on to your next question. The explanation about explanation you can read in explanation PDFs. Let's move on to 29th question. 29th question is, which of these are the methods of ex situ conservation? First is cryopreservation, second is seed banks, third is field seed gene banks, fourth is home gardens. So friends, let me tell you that it is a very easy question. You can obviously tell here this, that all of these are ex situ conservation methods. So ex situ conservation methods are those methods that are in which conservation is done of the plant or animal species outside its natural habitat. So when we conserve a particular species in its own habitat, and that is called the in situ conservation. So the solution is D. So let's move on to your last question of the day. That is 30th question. A tiger reserve is generally zoned into core, buffer and transition area. So friends, you might know, you might have had heard about them, or you might have heard about or read about the protected area network. So tiger reserves also come in them. So tiger reserves, they are generally divided into core area and buffer area and transition area. So here we have been asked that in a core area, which of the following activities are not permitted? First is tourism, second is mining, third is human habitation, the fourth is industries. So friends, let me tell you that all of these activities are prohibited in core areas. So why? Because core areas are the areas in which these tigers basically they live, they feed, and they reproduce, and they also they maintain their territory. So under Wildlife Protection Act, the government have to notify the list of core and buffer areas of tiger reserves in their territory. So friends, this is all about today's lecture. If you liked it, please like it, please share it with your friends. And friends, let me tell you that if you want to get the PDF of these MCQs, you can contact us on this number, that is 8968426481. So here is our contact. You can contact us at this number. So you have to just message us to get the MCQs. This entire PDF of the discussion you will be getting the explanation PDF. And friends, there are certain formalities that you have to follow for this, and that things will be told to you at that time when you will message us. And friends, let me tell you that why this format is important, because friends, at the end of the day, you will not be able to see long videos that are uploaded by us. So because at that time you will have multiple topics to revise. So obviously it will become a waste of time if you started seeing long videos. And also at that time you will have to revise things like economic survey and budget and India yearbook extra. So at that time you must have some kind of notes that cover your important concepts and that tell you that help you in revision, because ultimately at the end of the day, friends, it also becomes difficult to read NCERTs and for that matter standard books, because they are bulky, and after reading them to 1 to 2 times they become boring and monotonous. So reading them again and again will become it becomes boring, and in that case, but revision is important, because ultimately the role played the most important role is played by the revision. So for revision purposes, what you have to do, must have certain kind of notes which help you in your fast revision and which keep your interest at a high level. So these question answer format of is the best followed approach, and you must you solve the previous year papers as well as these questions and read their explanations, because UPSC is not just about seeing a question and its solution. UPSC is much more than that. UPSC is also about seeing why a particular option is correct and why others are not correct. So in this way you get the clarification of all your doubts. So in this case, if by covering one case you cover your four topics, because you are told in the explanation that why a particular option is correct and why other three options are not correct. So in this way, comprehensive revision takes place. So this is about, friends, today's lecture. If you liked it, please like it, please share it with your friends. And friend, if you liked our discussion, then please do subscribe to our channel, and please do not forget to press the bell icon, because then only you will get all the notification of important updates that we do on YouTube for the purposes of UPSC CSE 2019. So thank you.